Which brings us to the tale of NHS staff being warned this morning by the newish Secretary of State for Health that they could face a mandatory requirement to be vaccinated against COVID. The figure that they have put out, the figure that he has put out this morning, is 100,000 NHS workers that are not vaccinated. And I don't know why that is. And I do know that some of the reasons will be sound. Now, I don't want to fall out with you, but I'm going to lay down the law now on what is and what is not a sound objection to getting a vaccine. And by sound, I simply mean rational. And already you can see roughly where the demarcation line is going to be drawn. Rational does not involve listening to some Herbert on YouTube or GBBs talking absolute gibberish from a foundation of zero qualifications, okay? Rational for me includes history, and particularly with people from ethnic minorities, a history of being used essentially for experimentation by what we could loosely describe as the Western medical establishment. More stories from America than from the UK, but we started learning about this quite early on in the conversation, and I am certainly not minded to dismiss that out of hand. I guess 7 minutes after 10, I guess if you want to call it white privilege, you can, but you can use whatever phrase you prefer. My mind would say to people referencing some of the appalling historical injustices visited upon black, indigenous or people of colour by the Western medical establishment, my mind would reach for the argument that, yeah, I know that happened and it was awful. Some of these instances, some of these historical instances are absolutely unbelievable. I think the one that really curdles one's thoughts the most is the so-called Tuskegee experiment in Alabama, where 400 black men were enrolled without knowing in a 40-year study on the effects of syphilis, which involved them being untreated just to find out what would happen. So these are examples, and there are many. So my quotes, white privilege, end quotes, would say, yeah, but that can't apply here, can it? Because look, all the white people are taking the vaccine as well. But I don't know that necessarily that level of intellectual intervention addresses emotional concern. I don't know. But I do know that Sajid Javid is now heading in that direction. So, question number one, what do we think? And question number two, expressing some confusion, another former health secretary this morning said he doesn't really know why This is happening. If they haven't got vaccinated by now, said Sajid Javid this morning, if they haven't got vaccinated by now, then there is an issue about patient safety, and that's something the government will take very seriously. He didn't give a time frame, but he did say it wouldn't be months and months. I don't know why he wouldn't put a time frame on it. The guidelines are clear on all of these issues, but if it's not, you can tell I want to get the words right here, not least because I don't want the producers to have to waste time speaking to idiots. No offence, but if you're getting your vaccine information off, Uncle Keith's Facebook page, then we've got better things to do. 10 minutes off the 10 is the time. I see a tension between, it's personal choice when it comes to wearing face masks in the House of Commons, but if you're a nurse or a midwife, then you absolutely have to get vaccinated, otherwise you're going to lose your job. Is that a silly tension to see? I think if you're looking for leadership by example, then shouldn't you have mandatory vaccines in the House of Commons as well? In fact, that's not a bad starting point. If you currently are uncomfortable with the idea of mandatory vaccines for NHS workers, which I think is edging closer, that 100,000 figure is surprisingly high, although don't forget the NHS is, I think, the biggest employer in Europe. Would you feel more comfortable if every member of parliament without a valid and established medical, if every member of parliament had to do it, would you be more comfortable with the idea of it being extended to the NHS? Or, and this is partly my problem, I know what you're thinking. You have many. But this is my problem. I wonder whether I'm already bending over too far backwards to try to accommodate what I would call rational hesitancy or rational scepticism. And in fact, this is a bit of a no-brainer. You are already required to be vaccinated against various things if you want to work in the NHS. What's so different about this? Give me your valid historical reason for being reluctant and I will give you a fair hearing, and I may even come away persuaded that you're right. 0345 60 60 973. And the second question then becomes, isn't this a bit of a no-brainer? There's also no reason to suspect that the 100,000 people who haven't been vaccinated belong to this ethnicity, that ethnicity, or any ethnicity. So you know me, if I learn something, then I'm very conscious of how important it is to acknowledge that should perhaps change your mind. And when I learnt about things like the Tuskegee experiment and others, it did make me see things in a slightly different way. But how do we know what reasons these 100,000 people have for not having had the vaccine? Some of them might just have not got round to it. So it's the NHS. It's a massive public health threat. It's a vaccine that is proven to work. Therefore, if you want to work in the NHS, in front-facing public health roles, you need to have it explained to you very calmly and clearly, but the COVID vaccine is a deal-breaker. It is a no-brainer. You have to have it. We'll do our best, if you still refuse, we'll do our best to find you a role that can accommodate your hesitancy, your refusal, whatever you want to call it. We'll try and find you a job in a back office somewhere, or where you're only putting your colleagues at risk as opposed to actual vulnerable patients. But as a general rule, that's just going to be luck. If you manage to find yourself a role that can accommodate your refusal to have the vaccine. I don't want to be that idiot on the radio thumping his fist on the desk and shouting the odds. I like being that idiot some days, but I don't want to be that idiot today. I acknowledge the possibility and the historical context of potential resistance, but it would be very foolish to presume that every single one of those 100,000 people is, for example, referring back to an appalling syphilis experiment from the last century. I think it would be very foolish. So what do you reckon? 0345 60 60 973 is the number you need. So, all right, listen, I am here to learn from you about things I'm unaware of, not about things off your Uncle Keith's Facebook page or some attention-seeking micro-celebrity who can't get arrested in the job that he or she wanted to be doing at this stage in their life. So they've sort of reinvented themselves as ignorant anti-health campaigners. So forget about them for the minute. Maybe you can tell me something that I haven't heard before, something that I can think about. Blackmail is a word that Andy's already used. It's not blackmail, though, is it? I mean, you already have to have various vaccinations to visit various countries and to work within the NHS. In this country, are we in danger, perhaps, of being too accommodating here? If you want to work within the NHS, the way things are going and the way things have gone, we have now decided on reflection that you've all got to take it or find something else to do. And that's what I mean about being the idiot thumping the desk. I don't like that phrase. It sounds brutal. It sounds a little unfair. But what is more brutal? What is more unfair? Sending vulnerable people into hospitals and healthcare settings without the confidence of knowing that everybody there has done everything that they can do within their power to minimize their infection levels and their transmissibility. I think I saw 67%, the latest figure, for the reduction in transmissibility for between vaccinated people and unvaccinated people, whether you've had it or not. So it's the health service. When did we become a country that thinks that there are any more important issues with regard to the health service than health? If they haven't got vaccinated by now, then there is an issue about patient safety, and that's something the government will take very seriously. Sajid Javid said this morning, appearing to edge towards, or indeed, as he said himself, to lean towards, he is leaning towards making the jabs compulsory for staff in England. Why does he need to even think about it? And what do you think about the possibility? 0345 60 60 973 is the number you need. Let's start with Jermaine, who's in Vauxhall. Jermaine, what would you like to say?
I don't think it should be mandatory. I think as an NHS member of staff, we've done 18 months of hard graft keeping the country alive, following all of the guidelines of how to avoid spreading it, being very good with sanitising and wearing masks, you know what I mean? And the rates did go down. All of a sudden now we're being bullied into this situation where we're already on really low pay. A lot of the people on the team already are considering their positions with the 1% pay rise of people worked out to like 5 pence, do you know what I mean? And it feels like we're not even on good rates.
And do you know, oddly, as I understand it, and I'm open to correction on this, but the take-up rate diminishes the further down the pay grade you go. So the less qualified, less well-paid members of staff are the most likely not to be vaccinated. So,
well, because, you feel like you're being forced to put things in your body for roughly less than £10 an hour, a lot of people. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, but it's medicine. Think of it as medicine.
Fair enough, but you've gone through 18 months of keeping everybody alive. And you didn't even get a furlough where people.
Which, if we'd had a vaccine from the beginning, then you wouldn't have needed to do that.
But even with the vaccine, you're still liable to spread the virus. That's giving you a full sense of security.
Hey, Jermaine, let's not talk over each other, mate. The point about the vaccine. No, okay. Well, let's carry on talking over each other then.
No, I don't want to talk over you.
Good. The point about the vaccine, and I don't understand why this line has got traction. Nobody ever, as far as I'm aware, and certainly not in the last 6 months, has claimed that it is 100% effective.
I understand that.
Well, hang on. So the vaccinated people are much less likely, A, to catch it, and B, to pass it on if they end up catching it. So, no, don't stop, please, stop. Because this argument is so irresponsible, especially for a healthcare worker. You don't understand why vaccines.
I'm not saying they. What I'm trying to say is that it should still be a person's choice.
No, of course, but the reasons you're giving for your position are important to examine, Jermaine. It's the least I can do is respect the reasons that you give. And so far, the reasons you've given are silly. Because the idea that because it's not 100% perfect, so you wouldn't wear a seatbelt because people wearing seatbelts still get killed in cars.
No, that's not the only reason. The thing is, it's not 100%.
Right, give me some more reasons then.
It was granted under emergency.
Oh, here we go. Right? No, you see.
Now you're saying, where, yes,
again.
When does it stop? Will you have to have boosters as a mandatory? And if the, okay, if the so staff at NHS
again,
have to
again,
have it,
Jermaine,
why not everyone?
Again, well, I can see that. I like the idea. If every MP had to have it, would you feel more relaxed?
I think if it was mandatory for the nation, then fair enough. If it's just like sectors of companies.
But let's pick on MPs. I mean, let's just pick on MPs. You know the reason why the NHS. Well, you must know the reason why the NHS.
Yeah, it makes sense to an extent, obviously.
What do you mean to an extent? I mean, it's the same reason.
Obviously, there's always going to be some people.
So if all MPs had to have it, would you feel better?
I think it would go a long way to reassuring some of the public, especially with the
I don't care about anyone except you for the purposes of this conversation. I'm interested in you.
Personally, I've already had one of the jabs, and I'll be honest with you, I had really horrible.
I felt groggy for a week, but it's a hell of a lot better than being intubated. You know, it's a hell of a lot better than being intubated.
Yeah. So I had my jabs personally. Do you know what I mean? But
so who are you talking about here then?
In general, I don't think anybody should be forced to do anything they don't want to do. I think it should be a freedom of choice.
Yeah, but we are forced to do things we don't want to do every day, aren't we? We're not allowed to drink and drive. We're not allowed to drive without safety belts. We're not allowed to play chicken in the middle of the M40. We're not allowed to drink. We're not allowed to give our children bleach to drink. I mean, there's millions of things we're not allowed to do.
If you start giving people medicines under emergency powers all the time, before you know, every 5 minutes they could just be saying you have to.
Nothing is happening under emergency powers.
That's how it was released.
Again, these are just sort of, forgive me, mate, these are phrases that you've heard and you haven't. Can I ask what you do in the NHS?
I'm just a maintenance guy. I'm not a doctor.
Okay, but you could speak to some doctors, couldn't you?
Yeah.
Why don't you just do that?
I have, and I tell you what, yeah, at the beginning it was very scary because some doctors was like, don't take the AstraZeneca, it's causing blood clots in people of ethnic minorities, take the Pfizer, that caused a lot of apprehension. It wasn't just the internet. People were getting these rumours from doctors, you know what I mean?
But there weren't any doctors in your hospital telling you not to take the AstraZeneca vaccine.
There were doctors which were scared somewhat.
No, they were not, though. You see, you're making it sound as if you had this conversation at work, and you didn't.
I didn't.
No.
Are you sure?
Yes.
I had this conversation numerous occasions in the first year because everybody was concerned.
There was no vaccine in the first year, Jermaine.
Well, the second year then, but
I hate having to do this to you. I know that what you're saying isn't true. I don't understand why you want to say it out loud. And then you end up pretending you were having a conversation about an AstraZeneca vaccine before it even existed. And I don't understand it, but I'm grateful to you for all the work you do in the NHS. Speak to the people in the front line. Ask them what they think about these lines that you're being fed about emergency powers or about whatever the rest of it may be. Just go, you're so lucky you can speak to these people. Excuse me, I wonder if I could just have a word with you. I see you've been on the intensive care ward today. How do you feel about the idea that vaccines are X, Y, and Z? And then you can repeat whatever it is that you've heard. That's all. That is it. I don't know whether this would extend to maintenance workers. I suspect most people listening are a little bit confused about why it's even controversial. It's the NHS. Get vaccinated. 26 after 10 is the time. Frank's in Tyrone in Northern Ireland. Frank, what do you reckon?
Morning, James. No, I don't think people should be vaccinated against their will.
Nor do I. But no one's going to be vaccinated against their will, are they? They're free to walk away.
No, I think, unfortunately, it will be made mandatory for the NHS.
No, but they can't, can they? You're free to walk away. Let's not go down this road already of inflammatory language. No one is going to be forced to take a vaccine they don't want to take. They're going to be given the choice in the same way that I'm given the choice when I come to work in the morning. Go on the radio and don't swear, and you can carry on doing your job. Go on the radio and swear, and you'll be out of the door by the time of the travel news. No one's being forced. I'm not being forced to come on the radio and not swear. I'm choosing not to swear on the rest. So let's drop that language for start, Frank.
Well, unfortunately, James, you and I would disagree there.
We really wouldn't disagree there, Frank. Nobody is going to be forced. No one's going to be tied down and forced to be vaccinated. They're going to be told, if you want to carry on working in an environment where the most vulnerable people in the entire society are likely to come into contact with you, then you're going to have to be vaccinated. So already your point has fallen apart, but here you still are.
Okay, well, I'm not trying to make a point for forcing. I think it's totally abhorrent that it would be.
Nobody's suggesting it, but you're still talking.
Well, unfortunately, I believe that's the route the government will take.
Tinfoil hat wearing now, are we?
No, James. No, okay. But I do believe, unfortunately, that.
So not only are people going to be forced to be vaccinated, they're going to be forced to do a job that they don't want to do anymore. So what are they going to do? Frog march people through the hospital doors?
Lose their job, James,
but then
said,
they're not
they
being forced to do it, are they?
Okay, fair enough. I concede your point. Yes.
Thank you. Mark's in Brighton. Mark, what would you like to say?
I'd like to say it needs to be mandatory. In the United States, I have a son who works in a hospital in the Bronx. He was a staunch anti-vaxxer until they told him either you get the vaccination or you lose your job. And the day before that deadline came, he got vaccinated because he wanted to keep his job.
Yeah.
As simple as that.
I know it is as simple as that. But he wasn't forced to get vaccinated. He was forced, if you like, to get vaccinated if he wanted to keep his job. And therefore, he did. How is he, by the way?
He's fine.
Oh, but what? Really? He hasn't grown an extra head?
No, absolutely. Not only that, he's not magnetic either.
Well, that's a relief.
But, you know, James, when you talk about the Tuskegee experiment,
yes,
the reason why so many black people in the States are frightened to death about vaccines is because the Tuskegee experiment lasted a number of years after the development of penicillin,
yes,
which would have cured the syphilis.
And they weren't given it in order to continue mapping the effects of having syphilis. I mean, it is an unbelievably barbaric episode, isn't it? Unbelievably.
It is ridiculously barbaric, and it lasted until 1972. See, a lot of people think this was in the 19th century or something. It wasn't. It started in 1932, and ended in 1972. See, I worked for a good stretch for the largest healthcare workers union in the United States.
Okay.
A place called 1199 SEIU. Large numbers of those workers, and I knew a lot of them and know a lot of them. A lot of those folks are vaccine resistant for various reasons, not having to do with Tuskegee, just having to do.
Why was your boy? Why was your boy vaccine resistant? In a couple of sentences, if you can.
I think he had been reading crap on the web, quite frankly.
You've taken me right up to the news, have you? Oh, dear. You've got to laugh, haven't you? What's the alternative? 10:30 is the time. Mark, many thanks. I hope you talk again. I hope you ring in again. I want to find out how you ended up in Brighton. From the Bronx to Brighton, that is not a well-trodden path, but it's one I'd like to know more about. Do you know who it reminds me of? It reminds me of farmers, actually, this. I will never get my head around the alacrity with which people take up an invitation from bad actors to compromise their own welfare or livelihoods. I don't know why. I hope this doesn't sound patronising. I can imagine falling for it. I was raised as a Catholic, so I know the power of belief and faith. And I always remember, I must have told you this before, when I was very young, there was a family who went to the same church that we went to, and they had a baby that was born with a problem with their foot. I don't want to use language that might upset you, but you may be able to think of the phrase that was commonplace when we were young. I don't know if that's a phrase that's still in common parlance now. And I remember it being talked about by the grown-ups in slightly hushed tones because she kept bathing the baby's foot in holy water instead of going to the hospital. I mean, I think she'd been to the hospital, obviously, but she believed that bathing the baby's foot in holy water was going to effect a cure. So I do understand the mindset of wanting to believe things that are, or even believing things that are not very good for you. But I still struggle to look at the farmers now complaining, lamb, have you seen what's going to happen to lamb? I'm going to play you a little clip from a news bulletin in New Zealand later in the programme, because you're not going to get the truth at this end of that trade deal about what they've done to farmers. And farmers now queuing up to go, hang on a minute, I didn't know that this was going to happen. I didn't know that I was so... And those of us who said, oh, by the way, this is going to happen, feel presumably in the context of politics and Brexit, that's how doctors feel when unvaccinated people start turning up in hospitals. It's incredible. And you sit there thinking, who is it that you're listening to that is inviting you to endanger your health, your livelihood, in the case of farmers, your health in the case of COVID and vaccines, your loved one's health, or just your job? People are inviting you to jeopardise your job, because if you're going to be given a choice between public health and private liberty, then you're going to end up having to give up your job because of the nonsense that's been poured into your ears by people that won't be putting their hands in their pocket to help you pay the bills at the end of the month when you're walking away from a perfectly good job for ridiculous reasons. And that's part of the problem. That's what I mean by the circularity of this problem. You know, and I am very conscious of the socioeconomic argument. I touched on it with Jermaine. As you make your way down from consultant surgeon to the most junior and the most poorly paid members of NHS staff, so the vaccine hesitancy increases. Now, to me, that's really significant and key. I worry slightly that there might be a kind of historical element to it because of experimentation and because of appalling abuses visited upon people of colour in the last century by what we can loosely call the Western medical establishment. But still, if the resistance to getting vaccinated increases according to lack of qualification stroke, I don't want to say education, but, you know, that's the fact of the matter. Then, again, you know, a stop clock is right twice a day, but you'd think, really, at some point, if you were, for example, like Jermaine, working in a hospital in the maintenance department, you just ask the doctors in the intensive care department whether or not they've been vaccinated. And I don't get that bit. I struggle with it a lot because it breaks my heart to think that people are somehow being... And if I'm an expert on anything these days, I'm an expert on people who have been persuaded to act against their own interests. In many ways, it's my specialist subject for when I go on Mastermind, people who've been persuaded to act against their own interests. And here we are again, except the stakes are considerably higher than they are for pig farmers. 10:39 is the time. Tim's in Scunthorpe. Tim, what would you like to say?
Hey, hi. James, I'm absolutely incensed by this. I just do not see, and I don't wish to offend, but this is.
Well, try not
like
to then. Try not to.
Okay, I'll qualify what I'm
saying. Because I've probably failed on that one as well, but I don't think one wants to. You become part of the problem if you're deliberately causing offence. So be gentle.
No, I don't want to. No, this is what I'm saying. But what I'll qualify what I say. The reason I'm running is because look, I see the case here is that it is purely. In my opinion, a selfish response by these health professionals, workers, whatever. And I'll say that because what I'm saying is, look, it's about when you wear masks and vaccinations, yes, it's about protecting you, but it's about passing it on. And I'll give you the example. During the war, when people were issued gas masks, they were told that if it was a gas attack, it would kill you, okay? So people didn't hesitate.
Yeah. I'm almost a cliche of my own cliches. Actually, people did resist gas masks. I've been reading up about it. You had the sort of equivalent, they probably have a little gig on GBBs these days, but you had people claiming that gas masks were an infringement. You had people who were opposed to the blackouts as well because it's an infringement of my freedoms. So there's nothing new under the sun, Tim. But like you, I sort of blithely presume that they would have been a tiny minority, rightly regarded with ridicule rather than necessarily rolled out on national television programmes and given columns in newspapers.
I think it's fair for me to qualify what I'm saying as well, James. It's the fact that you know, I mean, I'm a veteran, for example. Same scenario, you know. When I heard the gas, and I was on the battlefield, I had 5 seconds to get a respirator on, otherwise I was going to die a horrible death. Now, what I want to say to these people, my sanction would be, simple as this, if you're a healthcare worker and you're working in hospitals, delivering a service to save life, and you refuse to get these vaccinations where it can be passed on, my sanction would be, right, I'm first of all going to give you an option first within 48 hours. If you don't get the jab then, I'm going to suspend you for 7, and then after that, I'm going to sack you. And that may sound really... I know, all this lot. Do you know what, James?
Go on.
Sometimes, being veteran, yes, we've got liberty. Yes, we've got rights and all that, but there's a strength in just sometimes sucking it up and, for goodness sake, believing what professionals and people are telling you, you know, just suck it up and do what we're told to do in the interest of your fellow people.
Listen, pot kettle black, straight up, all right? So don't think I'm unaware of that. And I have almost certainly veered closer to where you are, and I'm about to criticise you this morning. I've almost certainly gone further than you. No, but even if you say suck it up, that's normally something that is not good for you. So even that language is unhelpful. Take your medicine, I suppose, has a slightly negative connotation, doesn't it? Or cod liver oil or whatever it may be. But that language is...
I don't understand your point, James.
You don't understand
what you mean about some medications and this and the other. Where's the comparison to it? Can't you just see that, yes...
I'm not arguing with you, but if you say suck it up, it normally means... You sound like a PE teacher, and I hated PE. So do you see what I mean? I don't know that suck it up is the...
I'm far from that, mate.
Tim, take care. The line's going a bit wonky, so I'll crack on. But thank you. And of course, Simon points out, I'm cabin crew for British Airways. Cabin crew for British Airways, we have to have and keep up to date all our vaccinations and inoculations for us to continue in our jobs. It's nothing new, James. We're certainly not forced to do it. We have a choice. But then I don't know the problem, really, as is so often the case with people being persuaded by people who are very well paid and you know, in some cases, building whole new careers out of this to act against your own interest or to ignore expert advice. How much of that invitation is responsible for people ending up in these sort of rabbit holes, and how much of it is a more rational or reasonable reaction to things that have happened in the past? And my inbox is going nuts this morning, so it's quite hard to keep track, but normally I get a lot of thalidomide mentions in my inbox, as if because something terrible happened with regards to one medicine, which was specifically for women suffering from morning sickness and ended up causing terrible deformities to fetuses. that is somehow cited as a reason why... I mean, if you were really going to do that, you would never take medicine again. Do you know what I was reading this morning? Such is the glamorous nature of my showbiz lifestyle. I won't tell you precisely the circumstances in which I found myself reading this, but I was reading the side effects warning on the mouthwash in the bathroom this morning. And it talked about how you should seek medical advice if you become short of breath, if you struggle to breathe, or if you come out in a terrible rash, or if your throat starts swelling up, or something like that. That's on mouthwash. Mouthwash. Whatever you do, seriously, don't read the possible side effects of Lemsip anytime soon, if you're thinking of taking a... And that's the bit, how do I, as someone who only wants the best for you, tell the difference between honest, decent people who are frightened and dishonest, increasingly indecent people who are growing fat upon the fears of the population. And I worry sometimes that I bring Brexit into stuff too much, because I've watched this country become the first on the planet to impose economic sanctions on itself, become the only country in the world with an internal trade border, march headlong into labour shortages and price increases, all as a result of decent people listening to indecent people either being horribly and publicly wrong about things or telling barefaced lies for money and attention. So I don't know how much of that plays into this conversation, but I do know this. If Simon has to get jabs to keep his job as cabin crew, then it's not unreasonable to suggest that you need to get a job to get a jab to keep your job as a nurse. I worry about Jermaine. I don't know if I can reach. With genuine, he's had one jab, he doesn't want another one. And he works in the maintenance department in a hospital. Is that unfair? Should it only be healthcare professionals that have to get it? And how, if you are listening to this thinking, oh, crikey, yeah. How much of a difference would it make if everybody in the government did it? Or announced that it was compulsory? I presume they all have. It'd be a story, wouldn't it, if a cabinet minister hadn't been double-jabbed for no medical reason? How much of a difference would it make if every MP, if you had to get... I don't know. Is that problematical for reasons that I can't currently see? Because they won't even commit to wearing masks, this lot. And yet they want you to commit to getting a vaccine. And I know they're two very, very different things. And I presume you'd have to go a very long way to find someone daft enough to be opposed to both masks and vaccines. But if that political message is reaching you, oh yeah, it's a matter of choice, to take it or leave it with the mask, can you really blame people in the NHS for thinking it's a bit rich to order them to get vaccinated at risk of losing their job, while the Conservative Party in the House of Commons can't even be bothered to wear a mask when the chamber is full? Hi, James. Just been for a long weekend in France. Ooh, très bien. I come 50 in January. I'm going to have to stop doing nonsense franglais. Oh, well, I suppose the Prime Minister does it, doesn't he, in public, when dealing with French journalists. But I think we should all strive to be better than the lowest common denominator. But every time someone mentions they're in France or they've called from France, I have to resist this urge to go, oh, creme de menthe. So I'm resisting. Chris writes, vaccine certificates required in every venue, masks indoors and on public transport, no issues anywhere. You go into the restaurant with a mask, takes 10 seconds to scan your pass, after which you can demask and enjoy your meal. What is so difficult about that? Chris, je ne sais pas. 10:50. Oh, well, that lasted a long time, didn't it? D is in Reading. D, what do you reckon?
I think that all public servants should be mandated to have vaccines.
Oh, really? I mean,
I do. Yes.
Just so that, I mean, Jermaine touched on this. Yeah, of course you can explain. In fact, I'll shut up and let you explain. How about that?
Thank you. All right. The reason I say that is because you are in charge of people's welfare. And if you are in charge of people's welfare, then you have to take that seriously. Mm-hmm. You are allowed to not take your own welfare seriously. But when you are looking after other people, then you have to put that first, because that is your job. So, yes, MPs should be vaccinated. Doctors, teachers, they should all be vaccinated. You had a guy, I think he was from Northern Ireland, or he certainly sounded as though he was, and he said that it's about forcing people to take the vaccine. People are being forced, and what they're being forced to do is make a choice.
Yes.
You talk about liberty, well, you are at liberty to not do it, but your choices come with consequences.
And I don't currently have the choice or the freedom to walk into a hospital secure in the knowledge that everybody in there has been vaccinated, do I?
Exactly. No, you don't. And I think it's really important that if we, you know, we talk about life, love, liberty and all of these things, but they come at a price and you have to decide, am I willing to pay that price? I like my job. I'm a public servant. I am in charge of the welfare of others. So, yes, I do have to have that vaccine, which I have, by the way.
And the second strand of it is actually to stop people like Jermaine feeling picked on. So why should I? And I hope he doesn't mind me focusing upon the fact that he's not a healthcare professional. He works in the maintenance department, but nobody else in the maintenance department is required to get the vaccine, and it shouldn't matter because, I mean, it's a good thing, but he'd feel less picked on. That's why I tried to make the point about politicians. You see.
Yes, and I think politicians, they're supposedly in charge of the welfare of the nation. And I think part of the problem that they are now experiencing is that, I don't know, well, I'm sure you do remember, when Michael Gove, I think he was talking to Ma on one of those morning politics programs, and he said, oh, people are tired of experts and all that nonsense.
Yeah.
Now you need people to rely on experts, and they are sceptical.
When you say experts, we could just insist that everybody in the NHS adopts a fraternal and convivial spirit, D, in order to ensure that they don't catch coronavirus, as Jacob Rees-Mogg urged.
We could.
That might work. Could we not just try that? Stand at the door of every hospital going, are you feeling convivial and fraternal today? And if they say no, so I'm terribly sorry, you're going to have to stay at home. And if they say yes, I'm feeling very convivial and fraternal, you say, well, come on in and cure some poorly people.
You know, exactly. And I don't think, you know, the fact I may know my co-workers, I don't necessarily know their circumstances. And consequently, it is important for me to ensure that, first of all, I am protected, my family is protected, and that they are protected. I work with people, I'm sure we all do, who, for whatever reason, genuinely cannot take the vaccine.
No one has got any beef at all with people who genuinely cannot take the vaccine.
Exactly.
I think it has a lot of benefits to it. The problem is, if there's 100,000 people out of the 1.3 million in the NHS, then you know, one wonders how many there would be in the civil service or in the teaching profession. I do not know. 10:55 is the time. I attend a chemotherapy unit every 3 weeks, James. I asked if all the staff had been vaccinated and was told that we can't make people have the vaccine. My feeling is they shouldn't be working with highly vulnerable people unless they have. I mean, it's an interesting one. Here's Jacinda Ardern. I'm going to play you two clips from New Zealand today. One about farming and one about vaccines, which I can see a link between the two. But I'm a bit like the kid in The Sixth Sense. I sometimes worry I can see things that you can't, and that might be because they're not there. But have a listen to this.
You basically said this is going to be like, well, it's almost like you probably don't see it like this. The two different classes of people. If you're vaccinated or if you're unvaccinated, you have all these rights. If you are vaccinated,
that is what it is. So yep, yep.
Can you describe this? You were previously hoping not to be able to, not to have to do that, I guess, when we still looked like we could maintain elimination across the whole country. I guess that has now changed because...
I think it was less because necessarily of the elimination determining that, and more because we, of course, maintained, and actually we have managed very high vaccination rates generally without the use of certificates.
Asked there whether or not she would be creating two different classes of people, where vaccinated people are afforded certain rights that are denied to unvaccinated people. And as cool as you like, she just replied, yep. And I don't see what's wrong with that. I wish perhaps there was some more, I don't want to say respectable, but, you know, if you look back on Brexit and find yourself thinking, as I do, how could anyone ever have treated Nigel Farage or Digby Pudding-Jones or any of these Herberts as if they were worthy counters to points being put forward by Mark Carney or every prime minister we've ever had. And you might not like them, but if they're all saying one thing and Digby Jones isn't saying the opposite, how did we end up doing this? And I'm having a similar thing now. Maybe if somebody obviously respectable, not the bloke from JD Weatherspoons, but someone really qualified and important and respectable was coming forwards with these arguments, maybe they'd make a little bit more sense. But from where I'm sitting, it's the casual way in which she just says, yep, of course we are. And the way that almost every country that's currently lacking miles behind us, lagging even on this, is doing the stuff that we're having a hissy fit about. They're just doing it calmly and casually. There are protests in these countries. There are people unhappy in France and Italy with the direction of traffic. But that hasn't stopped the government doing what they believe to be best for the entire population. Oh, curiouser and curiouser. Karen's in Milford Haven. Karen, what would you like to say?
Oh, hi, James.
Hello, Karen.
First time caller, so a little bit nervous, but there we go.
It's only me.
I'm an A&E nurse.
Right.
Now, I'm not sure. It seems to me that every time the government drops the ball, are under a lot of pressure, they divert blame to the NHS.
Oh, yeah.
It's every time it's happening now, they're constantly trying to vilify us. Now, they're saying this morning that it's our duty to protect life. I'm afraid that the duty lies with them too. They've allowed thousands of unnecessary deaths by their inaction, by their constant dithering and delaying, and they love saying that, but it's applying to them right now.
Yes.
We are screaming in my department that we are drowning. They're not listening to us. So more people are going to die, not from COVID,
right,
but from waiting for ambulances, because they're not putting measures in place to protect the people. Now, all they're doing now is just pushing the blame back onto the NHS staff, vilifying us once again.
I'm sorry.
Ramping up that hatred and division.
Yeah, I hadn't thought of that. I'm really sorry. Thank you. I'm so glad you got on at the end. I've accidentally added to that a bit today, and I'm really sorry. And I will be at enormous pains moving forward to avoid that.
It just seems odd that this is twice now that they've brought this up, and both times it's been because of their woeful reaction.
I think, and I may be trying to cover my own back now, so I'll put my hands up to that in advance. But two things occur to me. Javid was asked about this repeatedly this morning. I don't think it's necessarily what he wanted to throw into the mix, but offered an opportunity to be more accommodating or more appreciative of NHS staff. He clearly didn't take it. And two wrongs don't make a right. So that we're I think, and you may disagree, and I'll be late for the news because it's important that I let you if you want to. That you've described two problems. So the problem number one is the absence of clarity and leadership that has caused untold deaths. And problem number two is the fact that people in the NHS, a six-figure number of people are currently not vaccinated. They are both problems, but the trap perhaps I've fallen into this morning and many others may fall into is the trap of letting one almost eclipse the other, perhaps.
Mm-hmm.
Is that fair?
Yeah, but it also leads to a distrust in the government because they're telling us one thing,
they're not doing it
all the time. The mixed messaging throughout all of it. They should hold their hands up because I think they're responsible for a lot of this vaccine hesitancy.
Yeah,
they create division and hate and they feed off it.
Thank you. I'm glad you were listening today. I'm glad you found time to ring in. Can I close with a quite an important question?
Yeah.
About your work in A&E?
Yeah.
Have you tried being a bit more convivial and fraternal in order to reduce infection rates?
No, unfortunately, it's PPE that helps us with that and the vaccine. Conviviality and fraternity, I mean, for God's sake, I've never heard such nonsense.
Thank you, Karen. Quick nod to the conversation in the last hour. A lot of love coming in for Karen there, the caller at the end. And I'd like to add mine to that. I think I needed that little reminder about the dangers of taking your eye off the ball that you should be watching and focusing instead upon a ball that you should be watching, but not as closely as the one you've just taken your eye off. And also on that question, a lot of you pointing out that in care homes this has already happened, and Constantine fits very neatly into the conversation we had last hour because he writes, I work in a care home as a maintenance man and the double vaccine is mandatory for me. Plus we get tested lateral flow twice a week, PCR once, wearing a mask all day long. I've got used to it. And now I'm pretty anxious when I walk into a shop and someone's not wearing a mask. And again, I'll say, for the not the last time, but the umpteenth time, those of us who are supportive of a better safe than sorry approach to things like PPE and social distancing, masks, are the people working hardest to avoid lockdowns. I can't believe this hasn't landed better or been made clearer. I it's so obvious, isn't it, that the best way to avoid going to stage 5 is to do a really good job at stage 1, 2, 3, or 4. It's so obvious to me. I don't know. And I possibly now I'm feeling all self-recrimination-y thanks to Karen. I wonder whether I've, in my very small way, added to that problem. But it's not a tension between people who want lockdowns and people who don't want lockdowns. It's a tension between people who can't provide clarity and leadership and people who really want it. And the clear message sent out by, for example, everyone in the House of Commons wearing a mask would just be good for the population and reduce any likelihood of yet another blooming lockdown at some unspecified point in the future. There are days when I wonder whether I should say the same thing on a loop for the entire programme. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, James, there are days when I wonder whether you already do. But, enough of that. I genuinely can't quite get my head around the difficulty in seeing that people who are speaking up for and indeed trying to do the right thing with regard to masks, social distancing, other issues, are the people doing the most to avoid the likelihood of another lockdown. The people doing the most to increase the likelihood of another lockdown are literally the people standing up in the House of Commons as if masks have gone out of fashion. I mean, literally, the people doing the least to help avoid another lockdown are the cabinet being photographed within hours of the Prime Minister saying that we should all wear masks in crowded indoor spaces. Could you have done more to increase the likelihood of another lockdown? And please to goodness we don't have one, unless we really need one, than claiming that conviviality and fraternity remove the benefits of wearing masks. Do you want another prediction? I think there's going to be an outbreak in the House of Commons. I don't know whether or not it would even get properly reported, but I would keep a very close eye on attendance rates in the House of Commons over the next couple of weeks. I could be wrong. You know, it happens. I can't remember the last time a prediction was wrong. But it's bus drivers today. The shortage of bus drivers caused by... Yeah, well, you know why, if you've listened to this programme over the last month or two. I think there'll be... I'm aware of one or two cases already, but I'm not aware that they've been properly reported, so I don't want to betray any confidences, but I would not be surprised if that were to spread. The just, but the just like.